So, the 11th of February is the International Day of Girls and Women in Science. And it happened to be that you are an excellent researcher in gender in science. So I'm really interested in having a conversation with you about this issue, which is very important. And first of all, I would like to know, what does gender inequality in science matter, Rachel?
Thanks very much, Marta. So gender equality in science, it's really important that we look at the data that's involved in gender inequalities in science and innovation. So for example, in the She Figures report, which is the European level report, which charts gender inequalities in science and innovation, we can see that in 2018, roughly half of doctoral graduates were women. But we can also see how this varies throughout different fields of study. So, for example, women were overrepresented in education, but were really underrepresented in information communication technologies and also manufacturing and construction. And this has implications in the labour market. So women tend to be underrepresented as science and technology professionals, and also as entrepreneurs. So for example, only 25% of entrepreneurs in the field of information communication technologies were women.
So you mentioned before different data according to disciplines. So, and how do these gender inequalities manifest in different disciplines?
Yeah, it's really important that we go beyond STEM, because a lot of the focus on gendered inequalities in science and innovation really focuses on the STEM fields. But for example, in 2018, I think women represented double the number of men who graduated with a PhD in education in Europe. And it's really important if we look at how women climb up the academic ladder, because often, you know, as we go to grade B, we have less women. And when we get to grade A level, which is full professorship, we're talking about roughly only 30% of women across the different fields. So it's really important to take into consideration the field, but also the vertical segregation.
So this lack of women in science has a consequence on how research is being carried out. There is definitely consensus that there is a gender bias on how research is designed and implemented, and the impact of this on what the innovations come to fruit. Can you give some examples of in different areas about that?
Yeah, it's quite interesting, Marta, in your field, in the field of digital health. In the field of health, for example, this is where a lot of work has been carried out. So, for example, medicines were often tested only on men. And throughout the whole research process, this means that it's very often that women have more adverse effects to different medicines. This can have deadly effects. So this is just one concrete example, really, of how not including a gender dimension can have really deadly consequences for nearly half of the population.
Yeah.
And also, if we think about economics, you know, we have the gender pay gap. So in Europe, the latest data shows that we have a 13% pay gap. So this means that for every euro that a man makes, a woman makes 87 cents. So if we don't include the gender perspective, this is a whole discrepancy that we're failing to look at. Or, for example, in terms of urban mobility. If we think about the different journeys that men and women really take, linked to caring roles, we can see how people who have a greater caring role make shorter journeys. So to drop off children, to pick up children, and this needs to be taken into consideration when we think about urban planning.
So Rachel, you had told us a lot of examples, and you know a lot about the gender inequalities. In your opinion, what are the most important gender inequalities in science and innovation that really need to be tackled?
Well, if we think about the latest advances in terms of science, technology, if we think about the deep tech innovations that are currently taking place, these are innovations that might be linked to artificial intelligence, to big data, to different learning, machine learning, and robotics, virtual reality. If we think about these types of deep tech innovation, and then we think about the underrepresentation of women in STEM fields, mm-hmm. but also the double underrepresentation of women in entrepreneurship, we can see that there's a risk that these kinds of deep tech innovations that are going to be really important for tackling great societal challenges not only leave out big, large sections of the population. So, for example, you know, these kinds of technologies, the kind of professions that are very well paid. So it's really important in terms of not only gender equality, but also in terms of when we think about developing these kinds of solutions. Mm-hmm. Because if we don't involve a more diverse population developing these kinds of solutions, they're going to be ineffective, and they might even increase different inequalities, different societal inequalities.
Oh, yeah. But tell us, how these gendered inequalities interact with other axes of discrimination in science and innovation?
Yeah, so there's an increasing recognition that gendered inequalities need to be taken into consideration with other different types of axes of discrimination and inequalities. So, for example, ethnicity, race, nationality, age, sexual orientation. And all this work comes from Kimberly Crenshaw, who in the 1980s, she was a legal theorist. And basically there was a case where Emma DeGraffenried, she went for a job at General Motors. She was a black woman and she went for a job there. And she was not hired. Her and three other black women were not hired. And so what happened was, she sued General Motors on grounds of discrimination. And it was seen that whilst General Motors hired, their argument was, well, they hired lots of black people. They hired black men to do the industrial technological work. Mm-hmm. And the women that they hired tended to be white women who were involved with the secretarial tasks. And so they argued they hired women and they hired men, but they hired black men and they hired white women. And so Kimberly Crenshaw, well, she really worked hard on looking at how it was these two different axes of discrimination that interacted. And this was a great big case that she took forward and developed lots of research based on this. And so in terms of science and innovation, it's really important that we begin to think about, for example, black women have a very different experience working within science to white women.
So in this conversation so far, we learned a lot about gender inequalities in science and innovation and how these interact with other axes of discrimination. But what can be done to promote more inclusive research and innovation?
Well, lots can be done to promote a more inclusive research and innovation system. So, for example, the European Commission have now decided that research organisations, public research organisations, cannot apply for funding unless they have a gender equality plan. Now, this means that lots of organisations that before were not interested in or did not develop gender equality plans now have to be able to receive funding. But there are also lots of different things that different organisations can do at the organisational level. So, for example, in terms of recruitment and promotion processes, mm-hmm. make sure that the people in charge with hiring, so human resources, have unconscious bias training, for example. Make sure that recruitment processes and promotion processes are fair. Also, an interesting intervention that's been carried out in research organisations is something called reverse mentoring. This is where people from underrepresented groups in science and innovation come together with decision makers within the organisation and they speak about their experiences. So when it's time to make decisions, that the decision makers can really take on board some of the experiences that underrepresented groups have felt throughout their career progression.
So you really mentioned a lot of examples about promoting more inclusive research and innovation, equality regarding gender. But are universities really following some of these initiatives, or are really involved, are really engaged with gender equality?
Yeah, so we have lots of, for example, this university at the Open University of Catalonia, we have the equality unit, which is really pushing forward a lots of different actions, gender equality, inclusive gender equality actions within the university. And we're also here at the Open University of Catalonia, we're coordinating the INSPIRE project. And the INSPIRE project is really about creating the European Centre of Excellence on inclusive gender equality in research and innovation. We have 14 different partners from Europe as well as from Latin America. And we're really aiming to develop the evidence base of how to take forward a more inclusive gender equality at the organisational level. And we take a distributed approach to knowledge production. So we have four different knowledge and support hubs led by leading academics and practitioners throughout Europe and Latin America. And we have an ambitious empirical research programme where we're going to carry out a European-wide survey to look at gender equality plan prevalence, implementation and impact, as well as carrying out almost 50 case studies in terms of gender equality plan success and impact, as well as equality, diversity and inclusion initiatives, intersectionality. And we've also got some case studies looking at regional policies to promote inclusive innovations. We're also establishing 12 communities of practice, and this is where different universities, research organisations and private companies can come together and share their experiences of the change journey.
Wow, this is really a huge job and really a great job. In fact, I would love to join you in this endeavor. Thank you. Thank you very much, Rachel, for this conversation and for your job, for your research in this International Day of Women and Girls in Science.
Thanks very much, Marta.